Hey guys, this is Tristan with Victorious Games. As some of you may know, I've been having a lot of fun with shape painter objects, and I wondered to myself if it was possible to create a complete functional analog clock using shape painter objects. Found out that it is possible, it's not that hard. Before I get started, I did want to give a shout out to the GDevelop Discord server. I was recently promoted to community contributor and got recognition from the community for the work I've done, which has been a lot of fun for me, and I really appreciate that. And I hope to see some of you in the Discord channel also. There's a great place for information as well as just having fun with other game developers. Let's show you how this is done. We're going to start a new scene. We're going to start by creating a shape painter object for our clock. We have our new object here. I'm going to rename it clock. For the today's purposes, you don't have to change anything inside the object. We're going to adjust these settings from the events. So this is our clock. It looks like a little square on the screen. I believe this is 32 pixels by 32 pixels. And we'll put it here kind of in the center. Let's start by building a white circle for our clock. Let's go to events with our clock. Let's see, draw a circle. So this 0, 0 is actually means the top left corner of the shape painter object, so relative to the shape painter object. And let's make this circle 250 pixels radius. All right. There we go. And I don't have any conditions, so it's going to draw this every frame. And that's actually what we want. Let's see what it looks like. There, we've got a circle. Let's just make sure the outline, let's make the outline a little bit bigger. So let's do clock, outline size, and let's set that to 10 pixels. I think by default it's like 1 or 2. There we go. So now I've got a thicker outline. Like I said, the position being relative, that's based off this. So if I scoot this over, you can see that it's following the where the placeholder is. So the 0, 0 that you saw there is actually this top left corner right here. Let's draw some numbers on it. This is actually very easy. If you once you see it, you'll know it's easy, but wasn't obvious, I guess. So let's create a text called a numbers, and just as a placeholder text, we will do 12. And I always like to do bold. I think it looks nicer, bold text. So that's about how big it will be. Let's just see what it looks like here. So that's about the 12 will look like. However, we need 1 through 12, and they need to be precisely placed around. You could do this yourself, create multiple, like 12 different number, or 12 different text objects. But the smart way is to use one of my favorite extensions, the create multiple copies of an object extension. And you can find that really easy. Just type create multiple copies of an object. That's where we're using. And so we will do that at the beginning of the scene. We're going to create numbers. And we want 1 through 12. Let's see, one row, 12 columns. And it really doesn't matter where they start because we're going to move them. So this doesn't really matter at all. We'll just call these numbers. Base layer. Okay. I'm creating one row, 12 columns. Let's see what that looks like. There they are. This is, you have to count them, but there's 12 12s right there. So now that those objects are created, we can do fun things with them. Let's create this is something I don't think I've shown before, but it's super valuable for you to learn. And it's called ForEach object event. So you get to it by this big plus sign, and you click ForEach object. And then it asks you to choose which objects the event will be repeated. And we're going to choose numbers. So what that means is that anything I put here is going to be done to every single object of numbers. And we currently have 12 of them because we created them right here. So we are going to start off with, let's do a sub event. And I like to do like a one-time setting of these guys. You can change their values. And let's start by changing the numbers. So we're going to change the text of the numbers, and we're going to set it to an object variable. The extension, the create multiple copies extension, automatically assigns several variables that you can use. And so we're going to use a object variable called CreationID. CreationID starts at 1 with the first thing that was created, and then it just increments. So what this thing says is for each number, we're going to modify the text. We're going to set it to the variable CreationID. That simple. And we're only going to do it once because we only need to change it once. Let's take a look at this. There we go, 1 through 12. Now we just need to put them in the right places. And there's a pretty cool action to do that. And that's called put object around. I want the clock and I want the numbers to, here you go, put object around another. This is super valuable. In fact, if you look at this little icon here, it kind of tells you. You have the object in the center, and then you have this other object that follows this orbit or could be placed anywhere on this orbit. And so what we're going to do is we're going to choose a center object will be the clock. And since this is the center object, then yeah, the numbers is the one that orbits. So the numbers will orbit this center clock at a distance. I think I liked 225. And as far as angle, I was going to use the CreationID on this too. So we have to do the numbers variable CreationID. And this is 1 through 12, if you remember right. So we don't want 1 through 12 because this is degrees. That'd be like degree 1 to degree 2 to 3, 4, 5, 6. And they'd be all really close. In fact, I'll just show you what it looks like. I always like to see how things work before they're fully done. So all I did is I put the numbers around the clock and I set their angle to be their CreationID and the distance of 225. Well, the CreationID is 1 through 12, so that means that this is like, if you're not familiar with how angles work in GDevelop, the angle 0 is right here, and then increments like this. So this is 90, 180, 270, and 360, and then it starts over. So 1 through 12 is right here. Obviously, it's too close. If you take, let's use my calculator. So if you take 360 degrees, which is everybody knows is a circle, and we want to figure out there's 12 numbers, that means that there's 30 degrees between every number. So we want to multiply the CreationID, which is 1 through 12, times 30. Let's see what that looks like. So CreationID times 30. And it looks like this. So it looks pretty good. The first problem I think I'll try fixing with this is that the 12 is not in the right spot. 12 is on the right side. And that's easy to fix because we know that there are 360 degrees in a full circle, a half circle is 180 degrees, and a quarter circle is 90 degrees. So if we add 90 degrees, if we added 90 degrees, the 12 would go down here. We actually want to subtract 90 degrees and the 12 will go to the top. So let's do minus 90. So we still have our creation ID times 30 degrees, and then we're going to add minus 90, which is like the offset to get the 12 at the top. Okay, there we go. We still have a problem that it's not exactly in the middle, and I believe that has to do with the fact that we're basing the center of our put around on the top left corner of that shape painter object. And the shape painter object is 32 by 32. So I believe we're about 16 pixels off. So we have to go 16 pixels over and 16 pixels up. And we can do that by drawing our initial circle at 16, 16. So instead of drawing 0, 0, which is the top left corner of the shape painter object, like so right here, this is 0, 0. I'm going to go 16 down and 16 over. That should hit the center. Draw it 16, 16. Let's see if this looks good. Okay, that did fix the offset of the numbers. Our numbers look good. Now we need to draw the hands, the second hand, minute hand, and hour hand. Let's start with the hour hand. To draw the hour hand, we're going to create a helper object that will help us draw our line. Let's do a new sprite, and we'll call this hour hand target, and add an animation. We'll add with pixel. I'm just going to change it to 8x8 because all I'm going to do is create a bright red square. Basically, what I'm going to do is I'm going to put this object, which is the hour hand target, around the clock like this. And then I'm going to draw a line from the clock to the target. So let's do that now. If we just start this, you'll see there's no lines drawn, but you do see that object there. Well, we'll make sure it's not visible in the final project, but you can see it's there. We're going to create a new event. First thing we need to do actually is copy this. This is the put numbers around the clock. I'm going to change that to the hour hand target around the clock. We'll just start by putting this at 0 degrees, which is the right side. It should be where the 3 is on a clock. The hour hand is shorter. It's the shortest hand. Let's do it at 150 pixels. And so all this is really going to do this right now is going to move that red dot 150 pixels from the center right at directly to the right. And we now need to draw the line. To draw a line with a shape painter object, you click on the shape painter, and we are going to do a line. And we're going to start this at the center, which we talked about. This was 16, 16 is the center of our shape painter object. And where's it going to end? It's going to end at the center of the hour hand target. So there's the hour hand target. And there's a built-in point, which is super useful. You guys should remember this. Every sprite has a built-in point called center, so you don't actually have to calculate it. Okay, how thick do we want this line to be? This is the hour hand. I think I'm going to make it, let's try 20. Let's see what this looks like. Oh, well, that didn't look right. Now I'm remembering why I did absolute, absolute positioning on my shape painter objects. Okay, I'm going to change this shape painter object. So draw shapes relative to the object position on the scene. So now with this off, everything we draw is going to be referenced based off its absolute position. So 0, 0 is right here. All right, go back to our events. We do need to update our first drawing. And instead of 16, 16, we actually need to draw it at the clock. X and clock Y. And I believe we're going to have to compensate for the 16 to get to the center. Oops, that says X. It needs to be a Y. Clock X and clock Y is the top left corner, and we want to get to the center of the shape panel. That's what I'm doing, plus 16. Copy. And we're going to use that for our line. Copy. Okay, let's try this. Oh, good. It looks better. So we're drawing from the center of the clock to the center of the sprite. Let's draw the minute hand, basically the same process. I'm going to duplicate this. I'm going to have a minute hand, duplicate, and I'm going to have a second hand. So we have the three targets. They all look the same, and it doesn't matter where I put them on the screen because they will be automatically moved with that put object around. But I will create them by putting them on the screen. And let's do some copy pasting of this. This is the hour hand, and we're just gonna copy and paste it. This will be the minute hand, and this will be the second hand. All right, let me just edit these real fast. The minute hand will be thinner, so instead of doing 20, we'll do 10. And then the second hand is the skinniest of all, we'll try with 4. So currently we have angle of zero for all these, and they'll just kind of get smushed. Let's do the minute hand at 90, which is down, and then the second hand will be 180. We want the minute hand to be longer, and we want the second hand to be a tiny bit longer than that even. Okay, it's fairly good. Remember I did the angles offset, so this is 0, this is 90, and this is 180. And of course 270 would be up here. Okay, we've got a clock. It's not moving at the moment, but that won't be too hard. Oh, I do want to do one more thing. See how there's these square angles? If you ever looked at a real clock, there would be a pin here, and that's how they actually make these things pivot. But we're going to put a pin here just to hide these weird angles and make it look more realistic. So we'll just do a center pin. We're going to do a circle, small circle. And I'm going to copy, this is the center, and this is the center Y. And the radius will be pretty small. I think I would like 10. Let's see what that looks like. Yeah, so the thing about the shape painter objects is when you change a setting, like the width of a line or a color of a line, it stays that way until you change it. So this center pin is a circle with a really fat, I believe it's, we did 10 pixels. The width, it's basically the same width as this. And the center is white. We don't want the center to be white. I just want it to be solid black. So to do that, we can click on our clock and change the fill color. And you can use this color picker here and just click on the black. So change the fill color to black, and then you draw the circle. Oh, we need to set the fill color. So we need to actually set the fill color here, which is the big circle. Fill color, and we're gonna set this to white. Okay, so now we have the fill color black here, and we have the fill color white. So, let's change the second hand. Second hands are often red on analog clocks. So to change the second hand, we need to change the outline color of the clock. And I'm just gonna pick this red. And we'll just put it above the draw statement. And let's see what it looks like. Oh. Okay, we have everything red. That means we need to change that line color to back to black. All right. Okay, that line color is black. Let's see how that looks. Okay, so now we've got our red second hand and everything else stayed the right color. I think the only thing left to do is to make this follow the correct time. To do that, we're going to create variables, object variables, and I'm going to put those object variables on the targets. To do an object variable, you have to start by selecting your object. And then, we're going to be doing a scene variable, not a text one. It's important that you know when you're using text and when you're not. We're just doing numbers, so this top one. And we need to set it based off the time. So we're doing second hand right now. Let's call this direction, because it's going to be the angle of the hand, basically, in the second hand. So we're going to set it to the time. Oh, and this is a special function that's built into GDevelop. So if I do time and put a string in the middle of SEC, which stands for seconds, this will always return a number that is the current seconds, so 0 through 60. We have 360 degrees in a circle, and we want to divide it into 60 seconds. So we're going to divide by 60, and that means there's 6 degrees for each second. So we're going to just times this by 6. And if you remember what we did before, we had the offset of 90 degrees. That's also going to apply here. Okay, so we're changing the variable direction of this second hand target, and we're setting it to the current time in seconds times 6. So this will give us a number between 0 and 360, and then we bring that 90 degree offset so that it starts at the top as opposed to starting at the right side. And the last thing I need to do is this variable is what we're going to change under second hand. Currently we have it set to 180 degrees. This is going to be the variable we just created. Second hand target variable, and I called it direction. Let's see if it looks right. There you go, we've got animated second hand. Let's do the same thing for the other hands, only with some slightly different math. Okay, here are the proper math functions that I have done. I'm not going to explain them in this video, but if you look at them, you might be able to figure out what I'm doing. We need to change the angle. Instead of being a static angle, we're going to change this to the minute hand, the hour hand. All right, let's see if that works. Okay, this is good. It is 11:27 here. Click 11:28, so this is exactly right. The last thing I'm going to do is I wanna hide these red sprites that we use to draw, to do the put around and to draw to. And there's two ways we could do that. One way would be just to say hi, at the beginning of the scene, hide, 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 just three hide statements. That works great, and that would work wonderful. I'm going to show you a way that will also work pretty easily. It might prepare you for some more advanced projects. So we're going to create a new layer. It creates it at the top. We're going to call this helper objects, because we don't really want those shown to people. We need them. So what we need to do is you create your layer. I'm going to leave it at the top for now, but let's click on the objects we want to go in. I think you can highlight all three and then change our layer to helper objects. And as you can see, they're now on the helper object layer. If we go here, you can still see them. And you have two ways of hiding them. You can click this visibility. So the whole helper objects layer is now invisible, or I guess hidden is the right way of saying it. And they're gone. The other thing you can do is move the helper objects underneath the base layer. That means that everything that's drawn on the base layer will basically be drawn on top of and block visibility. So you, in this case, you can see I don't have the helper objects layer hidden anymore, but you still can't see them because they're buried behind the stuff that was drawn on the base layer. So you can use either of those strategies in your games, and I'll help you. Okay, that's it. Hope you have some appreciation of the power of the Shape Painter object. It's what I've been using for creating my slider extension. I've built a checkbox extension. I have several ideas for more extensions using the same strategy. If you have questions, let me know. Please like and subscribe if you would want to see more of this stuff. Thanks. Have a great night.